The Tonight Show is next. Each of us is responsible for the fuel we use. For all it's worth, energy. Save it.
Stay tuned for an outstanding entertainment program, The Best of Carson.
From Hollywood, The Tonight Show, starring Johnny Carson. This is Ed McMahon, along with Doc Severinsen and the NBC Orchestra, inviting you to join Johnny and his guests, Michael Landon, Buck Henry, and Francine Neago and Bulan.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, here's Johnny.
What a good-looking audience. I think I'll go back and get into something comfortable. What were you giggling
I've
at?
I've introduced presidents, vice presidents, heads of state.
Oh, you have?
It threw me. I came along, I saw orangutan. I've never introduced an orangutan before.
I've seen you with an orangutan before. And you didn't introduce yourself either. Oh, you're interested in where do you live? The family. Want to thank you for that applause. President Carter would love a group like you that follows orders. Sign goes on. Yeah. How are you tonight? Good. You're tonight. My name is Johnny Carson. I am your... I find a little humor in that. Why did you think that was funny?
You're so cute.
I'm so cute. Grown man, cute. I'm your super comedian. My delivery is faster than a speeding bullet. My jokes are more powerful than a locomotive. And many nights I've wanted to leap off a tall building with a single man. You sound good tonight. We laugh. Occasionally. Yes, Minnie? There's a mouse loose in here. What? Or else you got the bad seat. One of the two up there. Crazy. Is that a woman or a man? Both. You're going to be easy tonight. This is nothing. I mean, let me tell you about last night. Once in a while, you get a crowd that they find absolutely nothing funny at all. Halfway through the monologue last night, one of the security guards came in and took away my belt, my tie, and all sharp objects. You know, today is the first day of the Chinese New Year. So, Gung Hei Fat Choi. I think, did I pronounce that correctly? Gung Hei Fat Choi. That means Happy New Year. Well, I'm here to educate. I didn't think there was anything amusing about it. I think it should be educational. If I can't amuse, I can educate. Did you sell it? It was the year of the ram.
Yes.
The year 4,677, I believe.
Yes, that's right.
Of course, Carol Rosenblum has been saying this is the year of the ram for many years. And it has. He's the owner of the L.A. Rams, you see. Well, let's go to the news and see if Walter Mondale has been located by a psychic yet. You know, the weather back east isn't still incredible. Washington is closed now. The National Airport in Washington, D.C. closed down. And I understand the senators were very upset today. They were all snowed in on Capitol Hill and had to actually sit through a vote. Why is my popularity waning? I came out. See, the trouble is, I peaked when I came through the curtain, and now it's got to be downhill. Protesting farmers are still in Washington, and they are angry at President Carter. You know, it's strange that the president has been less than sympathetic with the farmers. He's a farmer himself. But I think Jimmy Carter just does not understand that it's expensive to operate a family farm, especially if you don't have an account at Burt Lance's bank. Well, let's see. The Chinese vice premier, Deng Xiaoping. Love that name. You see his mother calling him when a little boy? Oh, Deng. very popular name in China. He is in Tokyo, Japan, and he went on a shopping tour. But I understand he couldn't buy much there. He still had only had American dollars. Way back, Clement. Do you know the strike you were talking about a week ago? There was an actor strike. I guess actors who participate mainly in, who do a lot of the commercials. They had a strike against the producers of, was that it?
And the agencies.
Yeah. And the agencies, and that has been settled now. Strike lasted 6 weeks, and a lot of the actors you see in commercials were not working at that time. Carl Malden, you see him all the time. He took advantage of the 6 week layoff, went to the hospital to have an ingrown hat removed. And many of the actors who get most of their income commercials, had tough times, but most of them kept in shape by rehearsing. For example, that actor who does that commercial, the diarrhea commercial, you see, showed up at the unemployment office and walked up and said, "Do you mind if I talk to you for just a minute about unemployment?" So he kept his hand in. Oh, tonight, well, actually, by the time you see this, I guess it will have been on. NBC's big new blockbuster called Super Train. And I understand they have put a fortune into this show. And they're looking for big things. I hope they get it. Because I understand if it is not a big hit, the network is going to sell Super Train to Amtrak. And Fred Silverman will be the new porter. Roll aboard! Oh, you know. I have some good news for you tonight from the government. You may have read this in the papers or seen it on television. It is now legal to make your own beer and wine at home. Yeah. It used to be a legal law, but now anybody over 18 can make beer, wine at home, and take it out of the house. But only if you take it for judging or tasting. Now, isn't that about the dumbest thing? Where are you going with that? Well, I got a judging contest tonight. That's all the four wives of America need now. They have enough trouble during the football season. Can you see it now, though? The husband sitting in a bathtub full of homemade beer. You know, watching football and yelling to the wife, "Keep baking pretzels." Well, what's new with the Lee Marvin trial? I want to keep you up to date on the really important news items today. You know, that's a really Hollywood trial. Not only is Lee Marvin the defendant, but Jimmy Stewart is kindly Judge Parker. If they were going to make a movie, he would be. I have a feeling, a sneaky feeling, how this whole trial is going to end. I think Michelle's going to get half of everything that Lee has, and the lawyers are going to get the other half. That's the way it's going to go. Right? Okay, we got to... Right?
Yes.
Right?
Right?
Right. Okay.
Bye-bye, money.
What, bye-bye? We have a good show tonight. We really do. Mike Landon is here. Mr. Buck Henry. We have... Mr. Willard Espy has written, that's nice for a writer, has written a fascinating book called Oh, Thou Improper, Thou Uncommon Noun, about words and their derivation, and Francine Neago and Bulan. Bulan, I understand, is an orangutan.
That's right.
Is that the one you had...
That's the one I had trouble with, Bulan.
How did you announce that?
Don't, please. You don't want to hear it again.
Why did, what did you say?
Everything that you could possibly say wrong. I did not get it right.
Did you say...
Orangabulantan.
Orangabulantan on the show. We have Bulan the orangutan. Now, say that. That's not difficult.
Bulan the orangutan.
You see.
Gee.
You got it. We'll be right back.
America's not going to be pushed around anymore.
Dodge challenges every brand of station wagon in America, including the imports, with the new front-wheel drive Dodge Aries K. Most wagons don't have Aries six-passenger room. Most don't have its high mileage. And not one has Aries' combination of high gasoline mileage, six-passenger room, and front-wheel drive. Aries stands alone. With Aries pulling for you, America's not going to be pushed around anymore. Aries K at your Dodge Ram dealer. The American way to beat the pump.
Ever feel like you're on a date all by yourself?
Get Certs, get closer.
When your husband says, "I love you," does he yell it from across the room?
Get Certs, get closer.
Only Certs has flavor crystals and retsin for great taste and fresh breath that lasts over an hour. So if your sweetheart serenades you from long distance,
get Certs, get closer.
Next Saturday on Centennial.
I have to know how you feel about Clemson.
I was in love with her, but it's over. Charlotte, will you marry me?
But Charlotte's chance at happiness explodes when Clemmer returns.
Are you real?
I've made some terrible mistakes, Jim. The worst of all was leaving you.
I'm going to marry her, Charlotte.
And the Wendells turn murder into deadly profit.
For 25 cents an acre, I can pick up half of Colorado.
Lynn Redgrave stars in Centennial next Saturday.
Chanel number 19. Witty. Chanel number 19. Confident. Chanel number 19. Devastatingly feminine. Number 19. The outspoken Chanel. Aren't you just a tiny bit curious about a fragrance with that kind of style?
Available at Lord & Taylor and other stores selling fine fragrances.
We are back, and if you've just joined us, we have with us tonight Mike Landon, Buck Henry, Willard Espy, and this lady whom I have not met, and you gave an introduction.
An orangutan we have not met.
She is the founder of the Great Ape Protection Project, and she's a specialist in orangutan behavior, and has been assigned, this is fascinating, and has been assigned by New York University to teach her roommate, and the roommate is Bulan, an orangutan, to communicate with humans. They're doing a lot of research into this, you know, thinking that animals now understand certain, I guess, speech patterns or certain signs, and someday, wouldn't that be weird all of a sudden you found out they know what's going on?
Mm-hmm.
Would you welcome, please, Francine Neago. Francine? Hey, I find this really fascinating, what you're doing.
Oh, it is?
I remember a couple of years ago, George C. Scott was in a movie called The Day of the Dolphin, in which they took it to its ultimate extreme, where the dolphin obviously was very perceptive and understood everything that we say. It used to be thought, did it not, that the difference between humans and animals was that animals couldn't make tools, and they found out that animals, in fact, could make tools. So what is now the basic difference, that man is aware of his own mortality where animals aren't, or what?
Animals are speaking now to us, and this is a tremendous breakthrough. For the first time, we can speak to an ape in our own language.
And when you say our own language now, we have to really kind of define it.
In sign language, it's the language of the deaf. We are teaching him Emislan. It's almost unaltered compared to the regular deaf person.
Right.
It's the same language. In other words, an orang can speak to a deaf person perfectly well, and if you were to learn sign language, you could understand him.
What I've always been interested in, I don't understand the difference between, for example, if you do a sign often enough and repeat an act, isn't that more or less Pavlov's theory? They see the particular motion you make, and they know that that means to, say, to eat the food.
Well, this is the way we all learn, though.
Yeah.
This is the way we all learn. You know, you learn that this is a cup just because it has a shape, and you've seen it often enough. And then you learn that this act is actually drinking.
Right.
So you mold him into what you want him to learn. You want him to drink from this cup, so this is drink. So you keep molding him time and time again. Drink, darling. Suddenly one day, and this was about 2 months ago, he will come and do the sign for you. Drink, mommy, I want to drink.
In other words, he's
so
telling you.
So you've established a two-way communication.
Rather than you initiating the action, he can knock him in. Are they able
suddenly to realize what you're trying to do to him? You know, you're trying to say, talk to me, talk back to me in my language.
Do you hope as you progress to be able to get entire sentences and things like that?
Oh, yes, definitely. Yes, you can get up to 700-800 words. It is being done now with a gorilla. So there's no reason why the orangutan cannot, because he's even more intelligent than the gorilla.
Is the orangutan highest on the scale of the ape family?
He is supposed to be, yes. We have to prove this with language, because this is a first test on language. But as far as tool use and invention of tools and so on, he is.
Must be fascinating. How long has this project been going on?
It's been going on 8 months now. Whole months.
Is it basically
in a home environment?
In the home environment. He lives with you just as a member?
He lives with me like a child in a home with his own bed and eating a table with us, because he's a 2-year-old, so he runs around. You have to run after him with a spoon.
Right. Before we bring Bulan, is that right?
Bulan,
out here, I think we should show them the film, first of all, because once he gets out here, you may be watching him and not see the film at all. So watch the film here, and you can see it right over here, Francine. Maybe you can explain what is taking place.
Well, there's a little bear, and an orang from Sumatra is going to meet this little baby
bear.
That's
Bulan.
No, this is not Bulan. This is a little Sumatran orang, 4 years old, and she's rather scared, and she has a very... She's doing a repetitive movement because she's been in a cage. And for the last 4 years, she's been doing this movement.
She just
hundreds and hundreds of times. And she would like to be friendly with him, but she's a little scared. And every time she's scared, she makes this
movement. Why is she falling down that way?
Because it's the repetitive movement she makes in the cage. She's the equivalent of an autistic child.
I see.
She has not had a rich environment, so you could not start a speech program on her. This is why you need a rich environment at home, so that he can develop.
Is that Bulan?
Now, this is a minister.
That's
no, this
Bulan
is not
either.
Bulan. This is a big ape, fully grown, and he's very strong-willed, as all the great apes are, and orangutans in particular. And he's going to get his own way every time. They are very inventive. They're tool users. He's got four hands. They're very good at imitating and inventing their own games. And here, this one is inventing a swing. This is in the Jakarta Zoo, where they've built platforms hoping that the orangs will like them, but they don't. They just use them as observation towers. And now we have the meeting of several orangs together, meeting for the first time, and they're very friendly towards each other. They're smelling each other for identification. This is the way an orang remembers whom he's met in the past. And he has a long memory.
Oh. Kind of like a singles bar, isn't it?
Here you have an orang trying very hard to do some tool use. It's the first time that she sees this piece of cloth. And she's trying to put it on herself.
Playing photographer there. Now, is that Bulan?
No, that's not Bulan. You're going to see him.
I'll see Bulan, okay. I get so excited, Francine. Have you figured out what he's really doing there?
They come from a jungle where they're just below the tree canopy, and what he's really doing is covering himself up, which
I thought orangutans like the trees. They like the height.
Yes, they do, and they're just underneath the tree canopy.
I see.
They're way up in the trees, and so they feel that they need
protection,
to cover
their
heads. They don't like the sunshine, basically. Mm-hmm. Here he's trying very hard to put on a clothing very much the same way as we humans put it on. He's seen us do it, but he's never actually had to do it himself.
That is fascinating. They look, you say you've been living with it for 8 months. They look very obstreperous. I mean, when they want to do something, they seem to do it.
Oh, yes, they're very stubborn and strong-willed. I've lived with them 15 years in Indonesia, in fact.
Right. Can't they tear a house pretty much apart, though? I mean,
they're
strong.
They're good at that. This is part of the fun. We had no phone working because he pulled the phone out and he pulled the curtains down. He broke the windows, but he's only a two-year-old and he doesn't realize what he's doing. He's going through the typical terrible twos.
Okay. I'm going to do this, then we're going to... How old do you think he'll be before you can maybe break him of some of those habits? How about toilet training?
Oh, I think another year or so he will be fully toilet trained. He's already beginning in the morning now.
Oh, yes.
And every morning...
He goes into the potty and...
The regular human toilet.
The regular...
Yes.
But why just in the morning? I mean, you can't...
Well, because I don't understand him when he says during the day, I want to go, please take my diaper off. And he's too young to be able to take his own diaper off. It's really part of the trouble.
So sooner or later, he'll be able to say, hey, it's time.
Or he'll be able to take their own diaper off and go there.
That's fascinating. All right, we're going to meet Bulan in just a moment. You do have him with you tonight, right?
Oh, yes.
Okay,
yes, of course.
All right. We'll be right back.
Grandpa, this one as hard as I could. Huh? I ran the first base.
Good boy.
And then I ran the second base.
That's terrific, Billy.
Yeah, and then I ran the third base. And he coached it, keep on going.
He did.
And it was safe. Should have been there.
Reach out and share a special day.
A real home run, Grandpa.
Yep, that's just the way your dad used to hit him.
Reach out and touch someone.
Next time you run out for fresh, wholesome White Hen pantry milk, just $1.49 a gallon. So make White Hen your dairy store.
Once you set foot on the Bodie Plantation, you best set your mind to working.
The Bodie Plantation was one of the largest cotton plantations in the country. Today on this very site is a United Negro College Fund member school, producing graduates who become doctors, lawyers, and chemists, and your contributions make theirs possible.
It's coming, and it's bigger and better than ever. It's all new and full of surprises.
It's the 110th edition of Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus. Three exciting rings of the phenomenal and the ferocious. Hundreds of performers from around the world with the all-new spectacular, the world's first circus in space. It's America's greatest family entertainment value.
Now that's the greatest show on earth.
The Greatest Show on Earth, Rosemont Horizon or International Amphitheater, October 22nd through November 30th.
Welcome back. We're talking. Francine, did I pronounce your last name right? Neago?
Yes, perfect.
Yeah, who has been keeping company, if that's the right word, with orangutan. You said now in the home for how many years?
I studied them in Indonesia for 15 years, but I have had Bulan for 8 months.
Right.
I'm sorry.
This really has a great deal to do, this experiment with preserving the species, because as I understand it, some years ago there were, 3,000. Something like that.
3 years ago, there were 5,000 left. Now, today, there are only 2,000 left.
Is that because of the encroachment of crops?
It's because the humans are chopping down the trees in a big way to make room for rice.
He insists on coming out?
Yeah.
Bulan is... Does he know you're out here? I mean...
He does, yes.
Well, if he's...
He can hear my voice.
I hate to introduce... How do you introduce a rat? Bulan? Can you call him from here, Francine?
Bulan. Come, baby.
Maybe he's going to the toilet.
You wouldn't dare.
Hello. And you have another interesting species there, too.
Hello.
Hello there, Bulan.
Hello, darling. Do you want to meet John? Yeah. He would like to meet you, I think.
Hello. Can I touch him?
Yes.
Tonight's guest host is...
Hi. Hi there, Bulan. How are you? A little hungry, I think. He's eating the desk. That face. Can I hold him? Or...
Well, yes, you were.
He'll
probably kiss you.
Hi. Could you come here?
Sit
Hello.
I don't think you do.
Orangutan is smarter than I thought. Well, he knows you, and he feels safe and secure with you.
Now he's identifying you.
Hi. You have a very strong grip. Hi there. Come on over. Bulan, come on. Come on.
He's more interested in the mic than in you.
Bulan? He gave me a little kiss, didn't you? I'll do it again. Excuse me, I'm not laughing at you. You're a nice-looking orangutan, but... It's a pencil. Now, what signs could you, if you wanted him to eat now, how would you say, Well, some of the...
He will do it this way. The proper sign is this way.
Now, here's some of the pictures at home, where you're feeding him, I guess. Now, is that one of the signs showing him...
Yes.
He just points to his mouth and says...
He points to his mouth. Says the regular sign is all the fingers together, but we made it easier for him.
Right.
Just one finger.
Okay, what else we have?
Because this...
Now, here you have him using an actual spoon. He uses a utensil? You're trying to teach him to use...
Yes, he's well trained. In about 6 months from now, he can eat like a real gentleman at table with utensils. He imitates us.
See, that's not going to be very good, that he ate the eraser off of the... Eraser. Can't learn it all in one shot, kid. Now, here's Bulan with a date, I guess. I don't know what that...
That's his favorite boy dog.
A friend of his, is it? He's got my cigarette lighter, and I don't want to set himself
he
on fire.
He lives two dogs. Maybe we should give him a date at this point.
Yeah, that's all
he
right.
He lives with...
Well, this is a, he lives with this dog? Two dogs?
He lives with two dogs.
How do they get along?
They sound beautifully together.
Right. He's warming up to me a little bit now, you see?
A little bit too much.
Mm. You will come to
would
me now,
like
will you?
Would you feed him? He might do the same
for
you.
Hey, Bulan?
You don't have to do that.
I don't
you
have
just
to do
simply
that.
Say, show him the food.
Food?
And, would you like to eat? Take a little piece.
Bulan,
and then,
would you like to eat?
Well, you have to turn your head the other way.
Bulan? Ah, you see?
Now you have to give it to him.
So there you are.
Well,
don't give him the whole thing. Look like figs or dates?
We haven't taught him to say thank you.
I was noticed. I was waiting for a thank you or something. Ed, I don't know how to tell you this, but he recognizes you from somewhere.
They're very good eaters.
Did you ever wonder what goes on in their mind of an animal? I know.
Well, wouldn't we like to know about our cats and dogs?
Yeah,
that's why I'd like to know about a great ape. What do they think? How do they think?
Can they think abstractly?
Can they form concepts?
What can they teach us?
They can form concepts. We know that from Penny Patterson's gorilla, Coco.
Right.
She is forming concepts.
It's all right. It's okay. It's all right. Now, how big will Bulan get to be?
He will be about 5 feet, and he will weigh almost 200 pounds. And he will be 10 times the strength of a man.
Well, couldn't that be somewhat dangerous? Yeah.
They are very gentle. I've had them as fully grown adults in my home, and we never had any problems. They didn't even pull down the draperies, because they are too intelligent, and they know that the drapery would never sustain their own strength. He has to learn. He's a baby yet.
All right.
By the time he's three and a half, he'll be quite wise.
Right. Huh? It has a good grip. Good strong grip. What else do we have here? Here's one here going... Obviously, in the bathroom, going into the medicine chest.
Oh, yeah.
Wouldn't you love that guy in the commercial to look through the other side about now? Mona! Yeah. Obviously, you've taught Bulan to go in and out of the door. Can he actually, in this picture here?
He can open any door and any lock at this point. He can open the two locks on the door with two hands, and maybe 1 foot and one hand simultaneously.
They're really inquisitive,
aren't
they?
He has great advantage over us.
No, he's just going out there. I don't want him to get in the lights there. He just wants to see what's going on, right?
Yes, he's fascinated by the lights.
As you say, a typical two-year-old will just plow through anything. What happened?
She's telling him off, and he doesn't like to be told off.
Oh, she's admonishing him. Bulan, come here. Come.
He's talking to you.
Bulan, come here, come here. Feels so silly. I don't know that that's a way to call an orangutan. Bulan. Come here.
That's the way he understands. That's sign language for car.
Bulan.
Got the pencil here.
Bulan. Come. Come. Keep wondering what's going on in her mind. So he will live with you for another,
He'll live at least another 4 years with us.
Right.
But I'm hoping to have some more, and I would like to preserve them, and that's the reason that I have them.
Hey, it's really fascinating. I wish you much luck, and maybe in another year or so as he progresses, could you come back with us and let's see if there's been some development? There probably won't be any development in us. We'll probably be the same, but thank you very much, Francine, for being... And Bulan, thank you.
Thank you.
You're charming. We'll be back in just a moment.
I wish I knew some magic.
Bake the magic.
Open the door to a wonderful show.
With Pillsbury chocolate chip cookies.
Make the magic of Poppin' Fresh Dough. Hot chocolate chips have a magical way. They can even make you smile on a cold, rainy day.
That's making things better.
You can make magic, you know.
We did.
With the magic of Poppin' Fresh Dough.
I could just feel all over like I'm tingling and alive and vibrant. Definitely, Sheeran-G is quite different. I like it.
This woman has been wearing an unusual pair of pantyhose. One leg of ordinary pantyhose sewed to one leg of sheer energy. Here's what other women said.
I like to feel feminine. I like to feel pretty. And that's how I felt when I wore the sheer energy.
I'm going to tell my friend about sheer energy pantyhose so that she can feel as good at the end of the day as I do.
Now, save on two pair of sheer energy pantyhose. Just look for this special display.
I love Illinois. I've been to every corner of it. The cities, suburbs, and towns. I've touched the soil, been to the factories. I know the people, their problems, their hopes, world peace, jobs, making ends meet. I'll face those issues in the Senate of the United States. But you know something? The job of a senator begins at home, in Illinois. Don't ever forget that. I won't.
Dixon for U.S. Senate. A senator from Illinois, for Illinois. Next on This Was America.
I'm William Shatner. The steam whistle was to be heard across the United States for the next 90 years. Within its warning cry, there was the call to move on, the suggestion of freedom. A nation already restless had found a new way to move.
Join host William Shatner for part two of This Was America, Saturday at 6:30 on Channel 5.
Tomorrow's show is on the air with Bobby Vinton later tonight here on NBC.
Do you drink a lot of coffee?
Do I ever?
How many cups a day?
4 or 5.
Then take the pledge.
Pledge? What pledge?
Now, repeat after me. A 26-ounce can of Stewart's Private Blend will make 20 to 40 more cups than a 2-pound can of ordinary coffee, so help me, Stewart's.
I can't remember all that.
Then remember this. Stewart's Private Blend coffee. You use a little less, and you get a little more.
I found a nifty way to fight inflation. The Purex Calendar of Coupons. It's an inflation-fighting plan tucked inside this calendar. You'll find coupons for savings on these and other Purex products, plus savings worth up to $25 in premium coupons on selected items from Corning, Sunkist, and more. For details, look for the display in your supermarket. The Purex Calendar of Coupons. It's the kind of dollar savings plan you'd expect from Purex.
Whoever said one man can't make a difference never met this man, Senator Richard Daley. He passed a Bill of Rights for residents of nursing homes, reformed the Illinois Mental Health Code, created a hotline for reporting child abuse, wrote into law new safeguards for the grand jury system, demanded stiffer guidelines on plea bargaining, got tougher penalties for drug pushers. You know what he's done as state senator. Think what he could do as state's attorney. Richard Daley, one man who can make a difference.
The Tony Tenniel Show, tonight at 1 a.m.
And Buck Henry is here, and this gentleman whom you all know. He has got one of the best shows on television, mainly because of his talents. He's not only a fine actor, a fine director. Little House on the Prairie has been going on for, what, 5, 6 years now? Seen on NBC, right here on NBC. Monday nights at 8 o'clock, would you welcome Michael Landon?
Michael.
Were you around the North 40? Were you today?
Of course.
Plowing, get up. Plow land, plant crops.
My car got stuck twice.
Maria's family. You haven't been here for... Well, it's been over a year. True?
I guess... Well, I didn't feel it'd be right to make an appearance on the show again until you did.
You've been talking to Bulan, haven't you?
That's right. We just shared an eraser together.
That's right. And a dressing room with you the next time after this.
We'll know each other. We meet.
I have been here since you were last here.
No, I know that. Now, John, actually, it's an embarrassment for me to talk about this, but if you recall, the last time I did the show, we discussed my coming over to your place to play tennis.
Absolutely.
And then I did see you once socially, and...
That's true.
You said, why don't you come over again and play tennis?
Right.
And, John, I only came to your house once, and you only let me touch the canvas. I've never played tennis at your house.
Well?
So what I'd like to do, I don't want to be pushy.
Uh-huh. But you're going to be, aren't you?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right here on national television.
Well, I like to play with the biggies. And, so I'd like you to tell the people right now that I can come to your place sometime and... I mean, just, you know, a set, a game, anything.
Well,
I'll pick up the balls and...
Now, let me explain. I've called you many times to play tennis. You are never home. Somebody answers and says, Mr. Landon is out taking pictures with his family. That's right.
Yeah.
They said you were out taking little photographs for commercials or something, and I said, well, I suppose that's
more important. Well, they were all pictures of my family standing in front of your tennis court. I thought it might get to you.
Trying to get in.
Yeah.
Okay, when do you want to play? You know, those people who always give an invitation, say, gee, you've got to come over to the house sometime. They never give you a date.
Do you have lights?
Call what?
You have lights? You have lights?
Yes.
Sure. Well, whenever you're done here...
If we leave now, we can catch an early.
Love you guys.
Nice folks. You want to play tomorrow?
Sure.
I'm going to ask you right here on national television. Tomorrow? I was going to put this in my book.
Name a time.
How about?
You're not coming. Is it a foursome?
Gotcha.
We're going to play tennis.
How about at 10 o'clock?
Fine.
Now, don't you have your show to do tomorrow?
No. I'm on hiatus.
10 o'clock, probably a little early for you.
Oh, no, I'd like to. How's 7 hit you, pal?
7?
Sure.
About 10?
Great.
Now, will you be there?
You have a rehearsal here tomorrow, the Mighty Carson Art Players?
Yeah, but that's not till 1 o'clock, is it?
Oh. I'll start without you.
Okay, now, we got a date tomorrow.
You got it.
Okay, 10 o'clock in the morning.
You got it.
Then you can never come here and complain again.
Well, I can, but it'll be about something else.
Although you can't touch the canvas tomorrow.
Oh, shoot.
I thought you were going to put a court in.
I did. That's why I came to your place, to see how the canvas was. You told me you had the greatest canvas in town?
Yeah.
Well, now you don't, because I have the same canvas.
Well, I don't notice a flurry of activity you calling me to say come over and play on your court.
Well, I never invited you. You invited me. You were going to invite me, and now I got to wait.
Well, why didn't you invite...
I don't want... You have a busy schedule, fellas.
But now that you put your court in, why didn't you invite me?
Okay. How about tomorrow morning at my place at 10?
I'm busy. I got an 8 o'clock tennis game. I'm sorry.
All right.
10 o'clock tomorrow morning. Anyway, how you doing?
Just
I don't know how you have time to play anyway, because I know what it is when you do that hour show, the times you have to get up in the morning and the time you put in. How do you get much time?
Well, but when you do a television series, you still have a fairly normal, you know, work week. I mean, you go home at night. It's not like traveling all over the country and so forth. I work my 5 days a week. I have weekends. Occasionally, I have to cut on a Saturday morning or something, but I do it very early, and I'm home for the afternoon.
Did you ever think when you started that show, because, you know, you came off of that very successful Bonanza show, of course, for how many years?
14.
14 years. Then went into this show. Do you have any idea you'd have such a hit on your hands as you do with this show? 5 years now, is it?
Yeah, 5 years.
Which is incredible in this business.
No, there's no way to. There are too many things that you just don't have any control over. Your time slot.
Right.
What network you're on. who your competition is. I mean, all those things. All those things enter into it.
Yeah, but you got a good show. You're good. You get good people. You got a good cast.
Yeah, we really have a nice bunch of people too.
And you direct. You've written some of them now, and you're doing some directing.
Yeah, do a lot of directing and writing.
You like that?
Love it. Love it. Because then if I'm out of a job as an actor, I don't have to panic. You know, I know I can always direct and write and keep working. I like to be busy.
You know, I've been in television for 20-some years, and I don't know one lens from another on a camera yet, or that end of the business, and I don't know why.
Well, I'm just... have to ask questions.
I don't know why I'm not interested.
Well, you just, you know, you're not. You're a busy guy, fella. All these tennis engagements and stuff.
You're so insecure. One time
just wanted
I asked
to remind you.
Well, if you put me on, I'm going to do a commercial here. I'm going to have to talk to you during the commercial here. We'll be right back after this. 10 o'clock. Come on.
It's never felt better. My hair feels so good and healthy. Know why? I colored it, then conditioned it in a whole new way. With Nice and Easy and its brand new conditioner, Lasting Touch. I got all this beautiful color, yet my hair's better conditioned than before I colored it. The clincher? All that soft, shiny, silky goodness lasts. Lasts longer than with any other hair color, at any price. Nice and Easy. It sells the most. Now it conditions the most.
Want a roast you can boast about?
No one boasts about my roast.
Oh, no one?
Especially Daddy.
Well, get Lipton onion soup mix. That'll make the most of a roast.
Lipton soup?
Well, sure. When you pour on Lipton onion soup mix and water, Lipton's toasted onion bits make a perfectly seasoned roast.
Mmm, delicious. Great onion flavor.
Now that's the most he ever said about my roast.
Soup up your pot roast with Lipton.
Your magic's in the air, and I know you won't play fair, but then you make me dare, you scoundrel. You're such a scoundrel.
Scoundrel, the bewitching new fragrance from LeBlanc. Beware, there's magic in the air.
You're my scoundrel.
Scoundrel by Revlon.
Now at Weebold's.
Picture a window. Now, picture a blind. Make sure it's a Levalor blind. With the matching Levalor Valance. Now give it definition. It's the new color edge from Levalor. Definition makes Levalor blinds twice as colorful. Yellow and brown, yellow and blue, blue and blue. Hundreds of decorator colors to choose from.
Lift the Levalor blind and what do you find? You'll find the Levalor name.
Definition by Levalor. It's the new way to picture a window.
We are back. Okay, we've got, Mr. Nelly, congratulations. You've been on 5 years and you were picked up for next year?
Yep.
Going on?
Mm-hmm.
Not getting tired of it yet, huh? A lot of people, you know, it's a funny thing. All of us in the entertainment business look for the day where we get a series, and so many entertainers, as soon as they get something, start to say, gee, I'm tired of this, and this is so boring, and et cetera.
Oh, I don't know. It can be a combination of things. I think a lot of people, when they first get a television series, let's say, I think they want to make sure that the public knows that it doesn't mean anything to them, so that in case the show's dropped, they say, I wanted it to be dropped anyway.
Yeah, I was really tired.
But in the meantime, they're in the corner, look, where's the rating? Do we have anything? I think if working conditions are good, as they are in our place, we have the same people all the time, and everybody cares about everybody else. That makes it nice to go to work.
You got a good company. Same way with the show.
You've
been on
absolutely.
The show a long time. We have a film clip, I think. Is this an upcoming Little House episode?
Oh, yes. As you know, our show is very moving, generally. We have a lot of touching things on the show, and this is actually one of the heavier moments in the show that's going to be on this Monday night.
And, I don't know whether to... When you look at me... I don't know whether you're putting me on or not.
No, you know, I don't.
I know you've had it with the blindness and some very tender moments. This upcoming...
Yeah, I think this will be kind of a moving thing.
All right, can we show the audience? Here's an upcoming episode of Monday Night.
Mm-hmm.
A deep, heavy...
Heavy, heavy.
I did not know what that film clip was going to be. When you looked at me straight on, there was, your eyes danced just a moment when you said, you know, we do these serious, touching episodes. I said, he's...
I like the way you did that, you know?
Thank you. They dance a
little
bit.
Yours are dancing.
You know when somebody's putting something on, they try to do it straight. Just a little giveaway there, a little...
Yeah, it's the show about an old woman who's losing a piece of property, and the kids try all kinds of things to enable her to keep the land by trying to scare the Olsen family off.
Yeah. If somebody came to you with a great movie role now, would you step away from this show and say, hey, I'm to a motion picture?
It'd be very hard to do during... You know, while we're doing this show.
Well,
and I wouldn't leave the show.
Yeah.
But, you know, until it's over.
You miss doing pictures at all?
No. I had my...
Because this essentially is a shortened form, a version of a motion picture, right?
Oh, yeah, I think we have very good quality on the show in terms of our production and cinematography and so forth.
Hope it runs for as long as you want to do it.
The only movie I think I'd really like to do is... I was a middle-aged werewolf. I really liked it.
That's right. There's been no good middle-aged werewolf pictures lately.
Once I did Teenage Werewolf, it, you know...
Were you in Teenage?
Yes.
What?
Oh, he was it.
I forgot.
You don't live in Hollywood?
That's right. Well, I don't get that from the film library to run, but, I mean, that's right. I was a teenage werewolf.
I'll send you a tape. I have a tape of that.
Gee, why don't you bring it when you come tomorrow?
I'll come to your house tomorrow, bring you the tape, 2 pounds of raw hamburger, and we'll watch it.
A biggie. We'll be right back. Buck Henry's here.
Okay, which is the new syrup with 1/3 fewer calories?
Well, this one is thicker. It tastes rich. So the thinner one must have fewer calories.
Okay, uncover the thinner one.
Oh, that's my syrup.
Yep, the leading brand. Now the thicker one.
Aunt Jemima Light? You're kidding. It's thicker than my syrup.
Aunt Jemima introduces Light Syrup. Great tasting, even thicker than the leading syrup, but with 1/3 fewer calories. New Aunt Jemima Light Syrup with a high-calorie taste.
It sure fooled me.
Meet Carrie. She knows what she wants, something better, so she switched from Scope to Listerman.
Its fresh, minty taste lasts long, and so does my fresh breath.
Eric's the kind who wants more zest out of life, so he switched from Scope to new Listerman Cinnamon.
Its refreshing cinnamon taste lasts long, too, and so does my fresh breath.
Fresh, minty taste.
Zesty cinnamon.
They passed our test.
Listerman and new Listerman Cinnamon. They taste as good as they work.
Know what only $1.99 buys you at Ponderosa right now? Your choice from two delicious dinners with all the fresh salad you can eat, baked potato, only $1.99. Our chopped beef dinner special or our fish fillet dinner special, only $1.99 each.
Now every Monday through Friday.
So hurry in. How do we do it?
You're asking me? Who cares? Just keep doing it.
Ponderosa, how do you do what you do?
Introducing new Ham Special Light. Special because it's great tasting, and light because it's less filling. Try new Ham Special Light.
Ham, very refreshing. Ham, very refreshing.
Mr. Buck Henry is here tonight. You know Buck, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
Buck is a very amusing gentleman. He is a writer. Not only a writer, but he is also an actor. And he co-directed with Warren Beatty, Heaven Can Wait, which is a very, very amusing picture. Would you welcome Mr. Buck Henry?
Morning.
Morning. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Can I see what that...
Says 78, Buck. One of them is my name.
Yeah. How are you, old 78? Nice. What is that for? Is that for a promotion of something, or just a...
No. It's a roller skating jacket. There's a group of us who are barely able to walk, who
who roller skate.
That is having a renaissance, isn't it? Roller skating for some strange reason. Well, I remember as a kid we did that all the time, and now the roller rinks are opening up and...
They're real fancy. I mean, the skates are real fancy, and people do things on skates that, you know...
I remember when I used to go, when I was a kid, that the skates, you had to have a key, and they just hooked onto your leather sole of the bottom of your shoes, and they were terrible.
Yeah.
Your shoe would come off and the skate and everything, and now they're all self-contained.
Oh, yeah. You can get a whole skating suit with a skate attached.
You slip in from the top and
you
go right in?
You slip in from the top.
I didn't know. I have not been roller skating.
It takes a couple hours to get into it.
How often do you engage in this activity?
Do you know Helena Kalyanotis, the actress? Helena?
No, I don't believe
she's
so.
She's a wonderful, funny actress. Anyway, she organized a giant group of potentially dangerous to themselves, mostly people in the business who take over a roller rink every Monday night and skate their little hearts out. And it's fun to go out because it's fun to skate, and it's also fun to see your friends slam into the wall and get concussions and break their wrists.
Hurt themselves severely. Do you take young ladies and then go arm in arm and do all that kind of skating?
You do arm in arm,
that
yeah.
was the whole thing.
There are trios, there's backward skating, there's... I can only go around in a straight line standing up with a look of fear on my face. That's my only activity on the rink.
You don't do any backward skating or that?
In a year or two, I'll be able to do none of those things.
I don't know why I ask. I don't see you doing anything particularly athletic.
I guess that's the reason I also haven't been invited to play tennis.
Well, my 10 o'clock. How about 10 o'clock tomorrow?
10 o'clock is a little early for me. My heart doesn't start till around 2 in the afternoon.
Are you a night person, basically?
Mm.
What time would be a reasonable time for you to hit the feathers?
When? The feathers?
Well, go to bed, hit the sack, whatever.
I...
2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning?
Yeah.
What do you do till 4 o'clock in the morning?
I think about things.
Like while you're staying up till 4 in the morning? Or?
Yeah, and how I'm going to get up the next day. The great god of insomnia attacks me quite frequently. In fact, this week, or she descended upon me and said, "Try and sleep, sucker."
You have bouts with that?
Yeah.
You know, I feel for people who have it. I know people who suffer from it. And have you tried all of those cures that they suggest?
No, I haven't. Well, because I'm not quite sure which cures they suggest. If I could figure out what it was it comes from, whether it's fear of going to sleep, and, you know, whatever you're afraid of when you sleep, that people will sneak up on you and hit you over the head.
Maybe it's a fear of not waking up.
That you will not wake up, or your feet will drop off, or...
It's a common one.
Common one. And, or whether it's a fear of not going to sleep, which keeps you from sleeping.
Are you unable to turn your mind off? Mm-hmm. I mean, things just start clattering through your mind and you can't turn it off?
Yeah.
Have you thought of running at night?
Well, you can't sleep. Oh, I see what you mean.
Not while you're sleeping. No. I don't mean running in place in bed. I mean actually getting outside and jogging, they say, is very good. Or deep breathing.
Deep breathing, yeah, I suppose so. I live on a hill, and by the time I get to a place where I had to jog, it would be morning anyway. But I don't believe in running unless something awful is chasing me.
I'm with you. I'm not into jogging. All right, we'll return to the clinic here in just a moment after a word from our station.
You can feel us coming now, a fresh look on the scene, with a whole new style of living, light and crisp and clean.
That's why now we say the age of 7-Up is here, because we love that crisp, refreshing taste, so light and crystal clear. Move it up, look it up.
Hey, Dave Parker's turning 7-Up.
America is turning 7-Up. Reach it up, feel it up.
Mike Schmidt's turning 7-Up.
America is turning 7-Up.
Rothschild's 97th anniversary sale, all wool three-piece suits, only $159. Versatile four-piece suits, only $149 during Rothschild's anniversary sale. The general election is Tuesday, November 4th. Polls are open 6 a.m. to 7 p.m. Be sure you vote. Your one vote can make a difference. The League of Women Voters can help you with information on the candidates and issues. For voter information, contact the League of Women Voters of Illinois.
The WMAQ Radio, Dancing Dollars.
Everyone's coming up a winner on WMAQ.
Hey,
those good morning guys bring me all the news, weather, traffic, and sports. You bet I come up a winner on WMAQ.
With big cash prizes, the afternoon affair, and Irene Hughes, how can I lose?
Everyone's coming up a winner on 67 WMAQ.
Thank you for being with us. Buck, thank you. Thank you, Ed. I don't know what's wrong.
Stay tuned now for The Tomorrow Show as Tom welcomes film director John Huston. And tomorrow morning on Today, a preview of the World Series. That's tomorrow morning on Today.
The Tomorrow Show is on the air with Bobby Vinton later tonight here on NBC.
The most famous German word in the English language is Beck's.
Beck's, the number one imported German beer.
The book that's taking America by storm, the new consumer information catalog.
Just look, federal booklets on home, car repair, food, and money.
Not sold in any bookstore. The new catalog is free. Write Consumer Information Center, Pueblo, Colorado, 81009.
Americans are deeply concerned over the economic failures of the last 4 years. When I became governor of California, we solved many of the same problems America faces today by bringing in a team of elected officials and private citizens. Working together, we cut the rate of government spending and turned a $194 million deficit into a $554 million surplus. We did it once, we can do it again.
The time is now for strong leadership. Reagan for president.
The Nine Lives Soft Moist Report with Walter LeCat.
Kitties, foil pouches were designed for the average cat. Average? Every kitty special. And this special can, the Nine Lives Soft Moist Can, lets all humans pour us a little or a lot, depending on our special appetites. The Nine Lives Can pours a little or a lot. Only nine lives. Yum! Good night and good eating.
Game one of the World Series, tomorrow night at 7.
Show we have tonight. Joining us tonight is a gentleman whose name has become synonymous with some of the best motion pictures of our time. He began his career in film as a writer. He went on to become one of the motion picture industry's finest directors, and he has also had a very successful career as an actor as well. His name is John Huston. His films include The Maltese Falcon, The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, The Asphalt Jungle, Moby Dick, The African Queen, The Red Badge of Courage, The Man Who Would Be King, a host of classic motion pictures. He has finally put it all together in his autobiography, which is called An Open Book, and he is here tonight to talk about his early days as a boxer, a writer, a newspaper reporter, an artist, and his career on the way to becoming one of the finest film directors of all time, also one of our better writers and one of our finest actors, Mr. John Huston, here tonight. My first guest tonight is Bobby Vinton. Mr. Vinton has done more for ethnic pride than any other performer living today. I shouldn't say any other, but as much as any other performer has done. His hit recording, My Melody of Love, not only unified the Polish-American community, but it also earned him the title of the Polish Prince. He has been a star for close to 20 years. He has a legion of fans, which numbers in the millions of people worldwide. And tonight he'll perform his two newest tunes. Bobby Vinton's records include, but are not limited to, Roses Are Red, Blue on Blue, Blue Velvet, My Melody of Love. And you can have the complete Bobby Vinton collection by sending $8.98 to Box. See those? I wonder if he gets money for those still. You know, they have these ads on the cable where they, you know, they show him singing all these songs. I think for $9.95, you get 400 records by Bobby Vinton. It's unbelievable. Nancy Friday is here tonight to discuss sharing and living out our sexual fantasies. The discussion will take about 2 minutes, and then, and then we'll spend, 20 or 30 minutes kind of, you know, living them out, what I want. Our congratulations from all of us at NBC and from the baseball diehards on the Tomorrow Show staff to the Philadelphia Phillies, who played an absolutely spellbinding series. That's all right, can you do that? The Philadelphia Phillies, who played five extremely exciting baseball games with the Houston Astros. And what do you say about Houston? Here is a team that was ahead Saturday night 5-2, finally lost the ball game, played an extremely difficult game last night. They were ahead for a while. The Phillies score five runs in the eighth inning to come back. Congratulations to both teams, the Astros and the Phillies, who will represent the National League in the World Series against the Kansas City Athletics, who disposed of the mighty New York Yankees in three fast games. I tell you, we were at the ballpark here, a bunch of us from the staff, on Friday night in Mr. Steinbrenner's luxury suite. Kansas City had a better baseball club for those three games, no question about it. George Brett, what is this reliever's name that does the... Quisenberry? Yeah. Fantastic baseball team. You know, when you go to a baseball game, I was telling the people in the room, you learn how much television has ruined it for all of us. A controversial play at first base, and you say, you're sitting in the ballpark, and you say, well, they'll show us that play on replay, and it'll be coming right up. And there is no replay at the ballpark. Television has really, I think, made it seem more unreal when you're at the baseball park. But in any event, congratulations to the Royals and to the Philadelphia Phillies. And the World Series begins on NBC here tomorrow night, which means that our show will be delayed until the game is over, unless it ends in regulation time. Incidentally, a number of people have written in here saying, you know, we read in the paper that Rona Barrett is going to be a part of the Tomorrow Show. When does that happen? Rona will join us beginning 2 weeks from tonight, October the 27th, and in her first week, she will begin the search for Bo Derek. We'll be right back now. Be right back with Bobby Vinton, right after these words from our sponsors, so stay with us.
Rayovac and Coleco announce a $10 savings now through November 15th. Buy any of these Coleco electronic games, head-to-head sports, electronic quarterback, quiz whiz, electronic learning machine, and buy two packages of long-lasting Rayovac alkaline batteries. We'll send you a check for $5 cash, plus $5 in refund certificates redeemable on Rayovac alkaline batteries, a $10 savings. Get details at your nearest store and save 10 big dollars now.
America's not going to be pushed around anymore.
Dodge challenges every brand of station wagon in America, including the imports, with the new front-wheel drive Dodge Aries K. Most wagons don't have Aries six-passenger room. Most don't have its high mileage. And not one has Aries' combination of high gasoline mileage, six-passenger room, and front-wheel drive. Aries stands alone. With Aries pulling for you, America's not going to be pushed around anymore. Aries K at your Dodge Ram dealer. The American way to beat the pump.
Hey, bet you could use a microwave oven.
Sure, but where would I put it?
If I move this. Then I gotta move this.
And this goes there.
Presenting the microwave oven you don't have to make space for. The Space Maker microwave oven from GE.
And this goes there.
Space Maker fits right over your range and even has an exhaust fan and work light.
This could go here.
You don't have to make space for a Space Maker.
GE, bring good things to life.
Stand back, Chicago. This is Evita. The 1980 Tony Award-winning Best Musical is here. Evita, based on the Peasant to Palace climb of Eva Perón. She was Argentina's instant queen and overnight saint, and only a few seem to notice she simply seduced a country.
Stand back! Buenos Aires! Because you ought to know that you're gonna get in me. Just a little touch and it's
just a little... Evita at the Schubert Theater. Call for tickets now.
Before all of Kansas City goes to the phones, I'm sorry I said the Kansas City Athletics were in the World Series. It's the Kansas City Royals. The Athletics used to be there, but they moved to Oakland. So the Kansas City A's Royals receive our congratulations, and the Oakland Athletics receive our condolences. My first guest tonight is known around this world as the Polish Prince. He has produced many, many hits that have been favorites of mine and yours over the years. Would you please give a nice welcome to Mr. Bobby Vinton. Robert?
Thank you.
You were back in my my homeland.
Right,
last
I was
night,
in
huh?
Green Bay, Wisconsin this weekend, and I told everybody that I was coming on your show, and they all said that you were from Green Bay, from Milwaukee, and they mentioned 10 other towns. And it seems that everybody wants to take credit for you up there.
Where did this name, the Polish Prince, come from?
Well, I was doing a show in Chicago, and the late Mayor Daley was a friend of mine. And
really and truly he
yes,
was?
Yes, yes.
How did you get to meet him and know him?
Well, through Roman Puczynski, who is a Polish alderman in Chicago, and he felt that it would be good for me to know the mayor, and it would be good for the mayor to know me, being mm-hmm. that there are more Polish people in Chicago than there are in Warsaw, or as many. Mm-hmm. So I went over to his office, and he gave me a Medal of Achievement from the city of Chicago. I'm an honorary citizen for being such a good Polish person. And I looked at him on the news with the television. I says, I'm not Polish, I'm Italian. Io non posso crederti quando dici che mi lascerà. And I start singing in Polish to him. And he panicked. And I says, no, I'm only kidding. And for some reason, he thought I was a character. And he liked that attitude in me. And we became friends. Well, anyway, when I returned to Chicago, the King of Sweden was in Chicago. And he was supposed to have a dinner with Mayor Daley, and Mayor Daley mentioned to the press that he would not be with the King of Sweden that night. He would be with the Polish Prince Bobby Vinton.
Oh, that's where it came from.
And it hit the Chicago Tribune. I made the front page of the Chicago Tribune with Mayor Daley, and since then everybody has called me the Polish Prince.
What about this thing Polish? You know, we've all heard the protests from the Polish people about the jokes and that sort of thing. Does that really harm the Polish community? And I'm sure there are millions or hundreds of Polish people now rising up saying, why is he even asking that?
No. Putting,
and I don't mean to do that.
Well, first of all, I don't really hear too many Polish jokes anymore. I think they're kind of dead. And at the time, they didn't bother me because I'm an entertainer, but I can see how they can bother
of course.
A community, and especially young kids. I mean, I have young children, you know, and people say, hey, the Polish jokes, and the kids say, why do they pick on us? So I don't think it's so much for the elders. It's for the young kids who don't quite understand why people are making fun of them. Mm-hmm. In fact, one story, one town I was in could have been Cleveland. I think it was Cleveland because the makeup girl is from Parma, Cleveland, and she said, you're very big in Parma. That's a Polish section of Cleveland. I was performing there, and a lady says, you must talk to my son, and I hear them backstage. Screaming, says, you have to talk to my 11-year-old son. So I says, okay, what's the problem? And she said, my son is on a baseball team, and they went to their series, the minor leagues, mm-hmm. and they lost. And the boy had some kind of a big Polish name. And at the end of the game, they were calling him, you dumb Polak, mm-hmm. and whatever. Mm-hmm. And you lost the game, and you messed up. So the kid said, I want to change my name. I'm ashamed that I'm Polish. And his mother says, well, wait a minute, you know, Bobby Vinton is Polish, and he tells everybody that, and why don't you go to one of his shows? So after seeing my show and taking this positive attitude that I take, the kid came up to me and he says, look, I'm going to win the game next year. I'm going to go back, and I don't want to change my name, and, you know, your nationality has nothing to do with your ability. And I don't know, he seemed to give me something mm-hmm. from all of that. But it's the kids, I think, that is the problem.
When you were a kid, was it tough because you were a Polish
no.
kid?
No, I went to a Polish school for 8 years. I thought the whole world was Polish.
I remember growing up in...
yeah, until I went into high school, I said, what happened to all the Polish people?
2, 3, 4. When I was a kid in Milwaukee, we had a large Polish population
sure.
there, and you never thought anything of it. There were never jokes told. Where did they come
from? I don't
from?
Know where these jokes came from. They just pick on certain ethnic groups now and then, and it was the turn for the Polish people. Could be the Irish next, and then you're in trouble.
Oh, no, no. When they get to the Germans and the French, then I'm going to be in trouble.
You're German and French?
Yep.
Well,
listen, what about this this thing where I see you on the cable, you know, where you're singing all the songs and we get the complete Bobby Vinton collection for $8.98?
Okay.
Are those really your records, or are they what they call pirated or?
No, those are my records.
They are?
Sure. They gathered all these old records, and they put them in packages, mm-hmm. and sometimes they're very profitable. In fact,
the reason I ask is sometimes they do use what they call counterfeits or pirate
records. Yeah, there are counterfeit
records.
Well, when they say pirate records, what that means is somebody will get a tape of a big hit song and copy it
yeah.
and just sell it. That's the pirate records. There's a lot of that going on today. They just make up phony labels, and they don't pay record royalties to anyone. They just make up their own records. It's a big thing.
I mentioned that your song, My Melody of Love, was a big comeback song for you, and that it established mm-hmm. you as the Polish prince. You've told the story about Mayor Daley. Was it really a comeback, or were you just kind of
Well,
not hot,
you know,
for a while, you know.
Show business is a funny business. You get hot, yeah. You get cold, and I was hot and I got cold. I mean, I still performed. I performed in Las Vegas, small clubs around the country. I was always working. It's just that kind of brought me back into the limelight again with a number one record. It's the power of a number one record today, what it does for people.
Was it an immediate hit? I mean, the first person
no,
to play it for,
no,
they
it didn't
it?
Come easy at all. In fact, what I had to do with the song is nobody, first of all, after selling 30 million records, the record company dropped me. I says, why? They says, well, you already sold all the records you're going to sell.
Over.
I mean, how many more can you sell? Goodbye. So I went to Italy. I had hit songs in Italian. That's how I started to sing in Italian there a little bit. And I went to Spanish. I sang in Spanish, and I sang in different nationalities. And I would tell this to my mother all the time, that, hey, I'm a big hit in Italy. And she would just say, why don't you sing a Polish song? And I said, well, there are no Polish-American type songs. She says, well, write one, and the Polish people will like you. So I wrote one, and I didn't really think it was going to be a hit, and we'd be talking about it on television all these years later. I was in Vegas as an opening act, performing, and I had my last $50,000, and somebody says, you should buy land with that. So I went around, I sold, I don't know if you saw land today, but you can't really buy too much for $50,000.
Not a lot.
Even in Las Vegas, it looked like a desert that was going to blow away, just a little lot. And I says, I think I'm going to take that $50,000 and invest it in myself. I'm going to make my own album, my own record. And one of the songs is Melody of Love. Well, then I went to the record company that I used to be with. I says, here's a song. I says, it's really different. It could be a hit, my Melody of Love. And he says, what is it? I said, Polish. He said, you're crazy. That'll never make it. I went to seven companies, all of the biggest record companies in the business. And I only say this because I know there are a lot of people out there who get turned down, and you shouldn't listen to anyone because nobody really knows. They all turned me down. They says, there's no way in the world that song would ever be a hit. And the last company I went to, they says, hey, it's not a bad idea. We'll take a chance with it.
Do you regard that as a miracle that that song made it?
Well, you have time for miracles?
Sure.
Okay. I wrote a book called The Polish Prince.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know what else to call it. I was going to call it The Italian Peasant, but I had to call it the
Why do you keep coming back to Italian?
Because I had my Italian friend with me.
I could do a terrible joke. Did you hear about the Polish guy who thought he was Italian, you know, and then it'd get everybody upset?
No. No, I have a lot of Italian friends here in town. Anyway, what was I saying?
You wrote the book, dude.
Oh, yeah, I wrote a book. And in the book, I tell of a miracle. When I recorded the song, this is hard to believe, folks. I mean, I hope you're sitting back late at night, whatever you're doing.
Trust me. This audience is on their second whatever.
This is
so
good?
They're okay.
All right. I recorded that song, Roses Are Red, you know, and it didn't really sound that good when I recorded it.
You mean on graduation day?
Yeah, Roses Are Red. It was an awful record that everybody on the session, they just looked at me. The musicians were embarrassed to look at me, and they...
What's he singing about?
Yeah, it was just... It was awful.
Roses are red. Of course they're red.
So I walked out after the next day, and I says, that song will never make it. And I had tried everything into promoting it, and nothing seemed to have been happening. And I was walking past St. Patrick's Cathedral, and it was like you see in the movies, those, you know, those scenes. And I says, you know, I tried everything. I'm going to go in and light a candle. So I walked in, and I saw all the saints, and all the candles were lit everywhere except for one saint in the corner. So I went in, I says, look, I feel like you. Nobody wants you, nobody wants me. And because nobody would light any candles for the saint. I says, I know I'm really asking you for a miracle, but I'm sure when this song, Roses Are Red, is played on the radio, make a miracle happen. Make it sound like a hit. Make it sound that everybody would like it and that it would be number one. Well, you know what happened? Actually, the song came on and it was a number one hit. So with every song after that, you don't believe this.
No, but now, every time I walk past St. Patrick's, I'm going to say, what the hell is going on in there?
So I went there with Blue Velvet, Mr. Lonely. I kept on going back to the same saint, and it was a Saint Espanola right in the corner on his side. And I said, boy, you really have been good for me. I'm going to keep... Well, after 10 years of selling all these records, I said, I can't go anymore. It's like asking a friend for a favor over and over. Enough's enough. I'm not going to come back anymore. I quit having hits. I got cold.
Really and truly?
It's true. I didn't have any more hits. I didn't know if it was just the timing and my time had come and gone, but I didn't have any more hits. And then, once again, I was with this record, My Melody of Love, walking down the street again, and I walked in, and I saw the saint again. I says, look. I told you I was never going to come back again, you know, and
but I lied.
But I really
I lied.
I lied. One more, please. One more, and I won't ask again. And it's a Polish song with Polish lyrics, and I can just imagine that St. Espanola say, oh, you're really making it rough on me now. You're making it rough. I says, just one more. Sure enough, that song became a hit. Now, once again, I'm in New York, and I says, I have to go to St. Patrick's Cathedral, and I really want to thank that St. Espanola. I'm going to light a candle, and I'm not going to ask any more. And I walk in, and the statue is gone. And I'm looking for all over for the statue, and there were a couple of workers working around. I says, excuse me, sir. I says, but what happened to the statue? St. Espanola used to be here. And they looked at me, they said, there was never a statue.